Good morning. Please rise in body or spirit for the responsive call to worship. Creator of all things, we glorify you. Loving mother and father of all people, nations, and races, we adore you. You whose arms hold Koreans and Bolivians, Rwandans and Inuit, we praise you. For Baptists and Orthodox, Methodists and Moravian, Congregational and Coptic, we give you thanks. With all your beloved children, we gather at your table to feast with our siblings in Christ, one in the body of Christ, one in your love. We worship you, receive your grace, and give of ourselves for the sake of the world. Alleluia. On the goodness and the majesty of God, we cannot help but recognize our own mortal frailty and failing. And yet God cares for us. Emboldened by God's love, we can be honest in confession, assured already of God's grace. Let us confess first in silence. now together. Gentle God, we are your children, yet we want to be independent of you. We are siblings, yet we want to be superior to others. You offer us your love as a gift, but we want to deserve it. We want to do things our way. We confess how deeply we need you. We open our hearts to you. With the compassion we have seen in Christ, receive us, forgive us, heal us of our fears, and set us free, that we may receive your grace as beloved children.
Hear the sound of your baptism in which you were claimed, called, and blessed by God. Friends, the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all children of the one God. Jesus is not ashamed to call us his beloved siblings and family. Our sin is forgiven, we are made one with Christ and with each other. Thanks be to God. Welcomed us, let us welcome all, strangers and friends. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace of Christ be with you all.
Peace to everyone.
Peace, peace.
Paige, are you okay today?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I just have a deep chest cold
okay.
Or something. I don't know what it is.
Okay. Well, I'll pray.
Thank you. Rick.
Okay.
How
are
you doing, Anne?
Hi. Nice to see you.
You look well.
It's deceiving.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. But it's not COVID. That's good.
No, it's
that's
going
a blessing.
It's going around, that deep cough.
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Is everyone else well?
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. Mary's not with us today, is she?
Mary.
I thought her name was Mary. Maybe not. She's the former teacher.
I don't know.
I may have gotten the name.
Oh, Gloria, this one.
Oh, Gloria, okay.
Yeah.
Gloria.
She taught art.
Good morning and welcome to worship. It is such a joy to see you all here and such a joy to welcome those of you who are with us on Zoom. Hello, Zoomers. And if you are a visitor with us today, I'd like to extend a very special welcome on behalf of all of us here at Brown Memorial. It's always a joy to have visitors with us. And if you feel so inclined, we'd be delighted if you would let us know who you are by filling out a visitor card that you'll find in the pew, or on the link to the chat box on Zoom, so that we can know who you are and be able to reach out more formally at some future time. We hope that all of you who are here will join us for lunch and in the assembly room immediately following the worship, and to stay for the faith exploration, which begins at 12:15. And today we're going to be having the third and final session of our conversation about hospitality. Let me say a quick thing about lunch. It's kind of by the skin of our teeth that we're having lunch today, but we are having lunch today. We need people to step up and sign up to be on the lunch crew if you're able to provide a casserole maybe once a month. And if you are not on the lunch crew but would like to get to sign up and be on it so that you'll get reminders to make your casserole, please see Rachel Cunningham. We really do need helpers for this, and that and ushers. So all of those of you who helped out with the festival on the hill yesterday, bravo, bravo, bravo. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. We have just a few goodies left over today from that. Usually we're overwhelmed with leftover goodies, but not so much, so that's a good sign. So today is World Communion Sunday, when we celebrate our connection with Christians around the globe. It's also the day when we collect the PCUSA Peace and Global Witness special offerings, one of the few special offerings that we take up each year. And in your bulletin, you will see a little brochure, and in it, it's folded up threefold, and in it you will find information about about World Communion Sunday and that this offering, the Peace and Global Witness offering. And there is a QR code that you can pay as part of your offering today for this particular offering, and it's in here. And also notice in this little brochure, there's a little write-up about gifts from our global partners that we put out around for various Sundays for communion, but we always put them out on World Communion Sunday. So this will tell you about the items that you see that have been gifts from our global partners in El Salvador and Cuba and Cameroon and Pachutazizi. So a little read on that. So, a couple of highlights to announce. Today is the day when two things are happening at exactly the same time this afternoon, so you have a decision to make, both important. One is at the Shrine of the Little Flower Roman Catholic Church on Bel Air Road. The announcement, the address is in your bulletin, having an organ recital to thank those who donated for the refurbished restoration of their organ, And that organ is going to be rededicated in honor of and memory of Michael Britt at this recital. And then also at 3 is the fall action from Build. And it's at Macedonia Baptist Church, just a few blocks west of here on Lafayette. It's really, really important to go to these Build actions. I think it's fair to say that had it not been for Build actions like this, the extraordinary event that happened on last Tuesday might not have happened when Governor Moore signed an executive order committing the state's support to work in partnership with the city and Build and such organizations to address the housing, the vacancy crisis in the city. Without Build and without these actions, like one, the one that's going to happen this afternoon, it probably wouldn't have happened. This is the way we keep pressure on. So they're expecting about 700 people today. And it's a beautiful day, so there's no weather inhibiting your going. But please try to arrive no later than 2:30, because they are expecting so many people. We'd really love to have the brown people to be able to sit together upstairs in the sanctuary rather than have to end up downstairs in the overflow room. So meet at 2:30, wear your Build t-shirt, and thank you for going. So next weekend, a little special weekend, celebrating Andrew's 20 years of service as pastor of Brown Memorial. Yay, yay, yay. We need to thank him after the first 20 years to get him feeling warm and happy for the next 20 years. So the festivities start on Saturday evening with a roast and toast and barbecue. We're not barbecuing Andrew, that's just roasting and toasting Andrew, but then a barbecue, and the RSVP is link is filled up, that is closed rather now. If you were want to go and were unable to sign up in time, please see Elizabeth Reichelt, and she's here to make sure that she knows that you'd like to come. And then the festivities continue on Sunday at church. It is church. There is no RSVP needed. All are welcome. And then we're going to have special guests at the service. And they'll be followed by a festive lunch afterward. Again, no RSVP needed. You are welcome to join us. So also notice in the announcement in the bulletin about this that there are two links regarding the Saturday event. One is to receive donations. Donations are welcome to help offset the cost of the events. But also anything that then is left is going to be offered as a gift to Build in Andrew's name. So just a reception. Thank you. But you're gonna feed us at the reception. So it's gonna be a good reception after lunch, after church on next Sunday. So thank you. But there's then another link where you can leave messages, either written or video messages for Andrew. So please see that. Please take notice of the prayers at the back of the bulletin and keep those people who are in special need of our prayers in your hearts and minds as you move through this week. A couple of updates. Elias Lara Cruz, grandson of our communications manager, Angie Ault, is no longer in the NICU. He is home with mom Maggie Hunt and dad Sergio Lara Cruz. And he is doing really well. So this is great news. So prayers of thanksgiving for him. And prayers of thanksgiving that Ann Babinski is back with us, yay, after her surgery. And that Ellen Fisher is with us after the treatment she's been going through. her treatments are going to be continuing, so keep her in prayers. And you know what? I'm kind of guessing that Anne can continue to use a few prayers as she continues to go through PT. And so thank you, thank you, thank you for that and for prayers. I would now like to invite the third to sixth graders to meet their teachers at the door to the assembly room so that they can go to Sunday school. And then the younger children will go to Sunday school after the time with children, and they are invited now to come forward for a time with Andrew.
Good morning, friends. I'm glad to see you all today. And today, Jesus, part of the scripture is Jesus saying to disciples, hey, let the children come to me. And he says a very interesting thing. He says that the kingdom of God, or another way to talk about it is like the world that belongs to God, that world belongs to people like kids, to people like you.
But there isn't two worlds.
Whoa, whew, okay, we're already getting into it. So before we go to the two worlds thing, what I was gonna ask you guys is, have you ever thought about what it's like to be a kid? To just like reflect on that for a minute. What is it like to be a kid? Because you're around a lot of adults, you're around other kids, you're around, you know, some adults who are a little older than you, middling older than you, and a lot older than you. So when you think about what it's like to be a kid, what comes to mind? Thinking about it? I can tell you what I think I remember it was like to be a kid. One is that other people brought me food to eat. I loved that part of being a kid. Is that true for you? Or do you make your own food? Do you make your own dinner?
Sometimes. I make my own breakfast, but my mom or the middle brother makes dinner or lunch.
Try this one out. The other thing that I remember is that I could go outside and play, and everybody thought that was normal. Like if I said now I'm gonna go outside and play, people look at me funny. But when I was your age, I could go outside and play, and people would be like, yeah, go play. Is that, do you get to play? Do you ever get to play?
Yeah.
You had a thought though, I saw it. Got it. So you're going to go for a hike with a cousin you haven't seen in a long time. That sounds awesome. So people bring things to you. You get to play. I had one other thought, but maybe you've had some thoughts. Well, I've had a couple about what it's like to be a kid. I think one of the hard things sometimes is you have to do what some adults tell you to do, right? Like, now we're going to go here, or now we're going to go do this, or now we're gonna go do that, or this is what's gonna happen. And sometimes that can be hard if you wanna do something different, right?
I like how my dad makes me go to the grocery store.
Your dad makes you go to the grocery store. Whew. Okay, anybody else gets made to do something that they don't wanna do? Just you, apparently. You're the only one who is made to go to the grocery store. Well, I think, yes, one more thought, Flora.
Speaking of the grocery store, sometimes I help pushing the cart.
That's fun, too. And sometimes they make those little carts, too, sometimes in some stores, you know? I like those carts. Oh, you prefer the big one?
Yes.
Well, we don't have to come up with an answer for why Jesus says this to the disciples. But the best part of Jesus telling the disciples they better make sure to let the children come to him is that you can always count on being able to go directly to Jesus yourself. That's one of the best parts. Like if you're having a hard day or a great day and you want to thank God for that great day, or if it's a hard day and you really need help getting through it and you don't feel listened to maybe by a friend or even maybe by a parent, you can go directly to Jesus, and Jesus likes to spend time with you. That was my favorite part as a kid. I think that's right. Jesus is everywhere. So for me, I don't know about for you, but for me, it's like then I can be in the spirit of prayer because I know Jesus is already there. Prayer world. I like that. The world of prayers. Yes, it's like a magical world where you teleport to pray. I love that idea. I love that idea. Let's just hold that idea. That's wonderful. I'm going to say a prayer and thank you for your thoughts today. One more thought, Flora.
Speaking of the word pray, don't get confused because there are two types of praise. One is where you pray in church and one is where you eat meat, which is pray.
I'm gonna have to really think about that one for a while. You've got me stumped. All right, let's pray right now. God, thank you for welcoming us as your children. Help us to receive you, just like all children receive the world. And help us to trust in your love and to come to you whenever we want to talk to you and listen to you, whenever we feel the need to be loved by you, and whenever we have thoughts we want to share with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you guys so much.
Got the most important prayer announcement for today is please, please, everyone keep in your prayers Sharon Holly and her whole family as they grieve the death of Sharon's son, Michael. And the memorial service will be on Saturday the 19th at 11 o'clock here. Thank you.
Let us pray. Mother God, hold us, receive our hearts, tend our hurts, embrace us in your love, feed us now with your word, and show us your way. Amen. The reading this morning is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 2 through 16. Listen for God's word to us today. Some, testing him, asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his arms on them, and blessed them. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. O Lord, uphold me, that I may uplift thee. Amen. When I separated from my now former spouse more than 5 years ago, some encouraged me to get up here and preach on it right away. Their pastoral experience, which I completely respect, was that a pastor experiencing a marital separation should get out there, speak to text, tradition, and experience, and tell people to mind their own business along the way. I couldn't do that at the time. My children needed trust from their father, which I could not build by preaching about their family as it was transitioning in real time. And I was hurting and ashamed. To fail is human, yes, but as a pastor, to fail in love felt nearly unforgivable. To preach from that kind of wound is sometimes possible, but almost never advisable. Preach from your scars, the saying goes, not from your wounds. Today, my relationship with my children has never been more solid. The wounds have mostly turned to scars, and I'm at a place where I can accept this failure, even sin, as part of the story of suffering in my own life that provides an occasion for an even greater reliance on the sweet mercy of God's grace. I hope to strengthen everyone today, whether you are married, considering marriage, divorced, or considering divorce, with the assurance that love is real, the covenant of marriage is a gift to the people of God, and grace is the only thing that can lead us all through. In Mark's gospel, as you heard, Jesus prohibits divorce. He does so as part of a test from the Pharisees that reveals how differently Jesus interprets the Jewish tradition from that of his contemporaries. Among most Jewish understanding and practice of the time, the possibility of divorce was never in question, only the conditions under which it might happen. While written sources, including the Torah and the Mishnah, only allowed divorce to be initiated by men, women, including Jewish women, did, in fact, divorce their husbands. Indeed, the reason the Pharisees went after Jesus on this divorce question is that John the Baptist had lost his head over it. John the Baptist had told Herod, "It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." He was speaking of Herodias, who had divorced herself from her husband to be with Herod Antipas instead. Herod Antipas, for his part, had divorced his first wife, Phasaelus, the daughter of King Aretas IV
of Nabatea in order to marry Herodias. This had caused an international incident. As Aretas sent an army to punish Herod Antipas, joined by auxiliary forces from the province of Syria. So Jesus fearlessly wades into these dangerous waters with a surprising answer. There are no conditions under which divorce is permissible. The Torah provisions for divorce were granted because of the people's hard-heartedness, he says. But marriage is established under an earlier covenant, made with human beings at the beginning of creation. When two people get married, they become one flesh. Not only that, but those who divorce and remarry commit adultery, since married spouses belong to each other in this indissoluble bond. This connection to adultery must have been surprising to the Pharisees, since under the law, adultery was strictly a matter of one man having intercourse with a woman married to another man. The marital status of the man committing the offense was irrelevant, for it was impossible for a man to commit adultery against his own married state, as one scholar writes. In a single phrase, Jesus created such a possibility and thus made the wife equal in this regard too. He not only forbade the man to divorce his wife, but also gave her a permanent and indissoluble claim on him as her sexual property. It's this sort of equality within the married estate, connected now to the possibility of adultery being committed by a man against his wife, which shocks even the disciples. In Matthew's gospel, after hearing Jesus declare a slightly softer version of divorce, prohibited except in the case of sexual infidelity, the disciples declare that it's much better than not to marry at all. They might be right. Indeed, Jesus prohibiting divorce doesn't at all mean that he is interested in strengthening marriages. At least some of his disciples and the women who follow him are married but leave their spouses behind, and Jesus commends them for it. In fact, Jesus says elsewhere, there is no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not get back very much more in this age and in the age to come eternal life. The kingdom is more important than the family in Jesus' preaching. The kingdom creates a whole new relational community that nearly supplants the household economy altogether. Marriage isn't ended, but it must conform to this transformed realm. So Jesus prohibits divorce, yet the church has never fully accepted the prohibition from the earliest of times. Origen, one of the earliest of the church fathers as they are known, articulated grounds for divorce, including parricide, poisoning, and witchcraft, allowing divorced people to remarry. Tertullian and Ambrose permitted divorce as the lesser of evils in certain situations. In the Reformation, Erasmus concluded that marriage should not be considered a sacrament, permitting divorce. And Calvin himself, while allowing for divorce only in the case of adultery, actually allowed more leeway in the case of the divorce of his own stepdaughter, Judith. Perhaps the church has learned through the years that we can't rectify one form of hard-heartedness by imposing another form of it on couples who cannot abide with one another for all sorts of reasons that are likely beyond our particular knowledge of their relationship. Or perhaps marriage has changed so drastically from the time of Jesus, when it served chiefly to protect the security of a couple's legitimate heirs, and produce future workers for the household economy, that to apply Jesus' prohibition, stripped from the rationale that undergirded it, can be anachronistic. The marital goods that were exchanged in Jesus' time were objective. Sexual satisfaction for the man and exclusive rights to a womb that he could be sure would bear only his children. But the marital goods that are exchanged today are primarily interior, affective ones: companionship, friendship, teamwork, mutual pleasure, and joy. Now, some seem to worry that getting divorced has become too easy in today's culture. I really don't know where they get that information from. The divorce rate hit a 50-year low in 2020, and the median duration of marriage increased to nearly 20 years. The reality is that divorce has become more equitable toward women, and as a result, women today are more likely to initiate divorce than men. This is a positive thing, since the patriarchy kept financially dependent women in unhealthy, sometimes abusive relationships with little recourse for change. And yet, greater equity in divorce has not made the process itself easy. Conflicts that were present in the marriage continue through the divorce, often making the process incredibly expensive. And to be frank, the process that our congregation put me through, in the form of listening sessions to attend to other people's difficulty with my crumbling marriage, was pretty painful. I'd compare it to losing a loved one to death and the community asking you to wait outside while they discuss how painful your loss is to them. But I also get it. As one elder said to me at the time, if this can happen to our pastor, then this can happen to any of us. That was a frightening thing for some of you to face, perhaps for the first time. Rosemary Radford Ruther, in her book, Christianity and the Making of the Modern Family, argues that the best thing the church can do to reduce divorce today is to encourage more preparation for marriage. I certainly could have benefited from that, and I don't just mean the premarital counseling that I received from the pastor who officiated my wedding. At the age of my own engagement, what now seems like the shocking age of 21, I could have benefited from a church declaring that my guilt over potentially moving in with someone or having sex before marriage is not a good reason to get married. I could have benefited from more models of healthy, egalitarian relationships where issues are worked through intentionally and with loving care and respect without fear or blame. I could have benefited from regular, affordable therapy to help me understand what issues I bring into relationships, where they come from in my family of origin, and how to be realistic about my own needs and red lines in relationships. Even so, the fact that I ended up divorced does not at all mean that I regret getting married. My marriage produced two incredible gifts to the world: my daughters, whose lives I am so deeply grateful for, I cannot adequately articulated. My marriage produced a lot of joy and growth, certainly for me, and I hope for my former spouse and for others I've been in relationship with through the years. My marriage was a gift for many years until it was not. And to Jesus' point about marriage not really being something that can be ended at all, my former spouse and I will be bonded to each other for the rest of our lives through our children and through the equitable division of my pension, among other things, that will basically serve both of us until our deaths. Theologians and psychologists today point out that during the time when Jesus lived, the lifespan for most people was in their 30s. Today, our lifespans are obviously so much longer. To survive a lifetime, a marriage must find ways to grow and change. As one of my friends says about his own lifelong marriage, we've basically been divorced and remarried now several times. I'm sad that my own marriage could not grow and change adequately to stay alive. And yet I've also been with couples whose lifelong marriage was so deeply hurtful to its participants, children, and family over a lifetime, that to celebrate it as a success seems contrary to the joyous joining that God had in mind. Today, I bring all of these lessons and wisdom to others in the form of the sermons that I preach, the counseling that I provide, and the community that we all create together. Couples I've worked with, particularly those planning for marriage, have expressed to me how helpful I have been in working with them to identify their own stuck places, the dead-end scripts that they get into, so that early on they can work together in rewriting them together. In a few cases, our work together has prompted some people to decide not to pursue marriage with a prospective spouse, to their eventual great relief and my great joy much later on. And here's where I experience contradictions that I can't fully resolve. My own divorce has produced some incredibly important fruits within me, and as a result, within the relationships that are most important to me. Had I not divorced, I highly doubt that my children would have the depth of the relationship they now have with me, nor would they have grown as much or perhaps as quickly as they have in their own understanding of who they are in relationships today. Had I not divorced, I would not have been able to help other couples sort through the most fearsome parts of their conflicts that I would have actively and unconsciously helped them avoid while still married and trying to avoid similar conflicts myself. And had I not divorced, I don't think I would have become as free in my emotional life to give my full self in joy, not simply in obligation to Christ's work in the church. I've seen something similar in some who have lived through divorce. People who have become more fully the persons God intended them to become. Some of their relationships, some of your relationships, have blossomed into the life-giving, neighbor-loving spaces that were absent, anemic, or perhaps impossible in their previous marriage. None of this makes the process of divorce any less painful, nor does it make it right. It does mean that when someone chooses that pain and the public shame that still goes with it, they were likely already in a lot of pain to begin with. No one that I've ever met has ever entered a marriage hoping to get divorced. We all bring the hope of a lifelong covenant that expresses the lifelong covenant that God extends to us. And I am so thankful that many of you have experienced and continue to experience exactly that. You are an inspiration to me and to others. Your relationships are so key in shedding light on God's hope for those who are called into marriage. What I've learned from many of you is that there is no one-size-fits-all way to be married to someone else. There is a constant negotiation between the ideal of unconditional love and the reality of horse trading needs and desires that each couple has to figure out for themselves. That is hard work, but it is good work that can make you more open and available to pursue your calling in the world. I thank God when couples succeed at that over a lifetime. For those of you like me, whose marriages have not had that kind of lifelong success, God does not love you any less. Indeed, by bookending this divorce text with the warning not to box out children from getting close to Jesus, he reminds the church that those who are considered lower on whatever hierarchies that we create, whether inside the church or the culture, they are the ones who will find it easier to enter the kingdom. None of us can ever earn a place there. It has to be received. I'm thankful that my own divorce has been one way that I have learned more deeply the truth of this grace. Today is World Communion Sunday, which is probably one reason that most people rarely ever hear this text preached. That's unfortunate, since World Communion Sunday is both a celebration of the unity that we have in Christ and a reminder of the denominational divorces that reveal our brokenness, our inability to achieve, in fact, what God has in mind for us all as one body of Christ in the world. The unity that God intends in marriage is similar to the unity that God intends among all people. That's why we pray for that kind of unity. When we fail in it, we confess our sin and we pray for it even more. So often, God responds with grace that surprises us. The first year I went through Christmas on my own, I mentioned to my friends and my preaching group how painful it would be on Christmas morning all by myself. I had put up a tree in early Advent, forgetting that I had no ornaments of my own. The season of hope seemed more like the season of reminding me what I had lost. Amazingly, the next week, a package arrived in the mail. Inside of it was just an ornament, just one. The next day, another package arrived with another ornament, then another. Each day, my tree received a little gift. My spirit received a little more light and life. When Christmas finally arrived, I was sad and lonely, yes, but also reminded of how much I was loved. Grace is like that. It doesn't cancel out the hurt. It just gets you through it with a reminder that however deeply you may flounder or fail in life or in love, God's love never fails for you.
Please rise and join with me as we affirm what we believe. We love you, God, infinite creator of all that is, and we rejoice that we are your children. We come from you. We are born of your love. You create us as living images of you and your grace. We follow you, Jesus, Christ of God, Word made flesh, love made real. You healed and taught. You welcomed and blessed all God's children.
You included all people as siblings. You included the outcasts, the wounded, the children. For your love and courage, you were crucified. But in love, God raised you from the dead. You live among us, calling, guiding, blessing. Holy Spirit, we live by your grace and power in us. You lead us to live lives of love and courage, to bless all our siblings, to live together as children of God in harmony and joy. We give thanks to you, O God, Creator Christ and Holy Spirit, and promise to live as children of your love. Amen. You may be seated. On World Communion Sunday, we are especially mindful of our connection to the global church and our call to work for peace and justice. Our financial gifts add to our offerings of time, energy, and love as we seek to be people of peace and reconciliation. We have received an abundance from God, and from that abundance, let us give joyfully and generously. As always, you may give by placing cash or a check in the offering plate as it comes to you, or by using the QR code in your bulletin or the giving link in the chat box. And today we invite you to please give generously to the special offering by the QR code that is in that insert in your bulletin.
Thank you.
Holy God, we trust in the provision of your love and the abundance of your grace. May the gifts we offer sow seeds of justice and peace. Enable us to use them according to your will until each child finds welcome and all of creation is healed and reconciled to you. Amen. You may be seated.
We will be serving communion today by intinction. Ushers will direct you to come forward by the center aisle. And after serving yourself, please return to your seat by the side aisles. The elements are gluten-free and non-alcoholic so that all may comfortably partake.
On this World Communion Sunday, we celebrate that we join our Christian siblings across the globe as we gather around this table. This table extends far beyond our place of worship, and there is room enough for all.
Can you see it? Can we envision the great diversity of God's children celebrating today in a global diaspora, foreshadowing God's beloved community? At this table, Christ is our host, which means that the circle is drawn wide and we are all guests, invited to be renewed in our discipleship as we share in a taste of what is yet to come. Come, taste, and see that God is good.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to our God.
Let us give thanks to the Holy One, our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise. There is nothing more right than to give you thanks and praise, O God. In a dance of creative spark and divine love, you made all that is. Dazzling galaxies and pulsing protozoa, canopies of green leaves and ocean floors of living coral.
You created humanity and called it very good. You gave us intellect and the capacity for growth. But we misused our gifts. We turned from you, but you did not turn from us.
You sent Jesus to show us the depth of your love for us, to call us back to faithfulness by the example of his own life, and to welcome us as his siblings and your beloved children. Therefore, we praise you, joining the heavenly chorus and the global choir, singing forever to the glory of your name.
Son Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. He came as a teacher, a healer, and a peacemaker. But in living out your love, he encountered and confronted the death-dealing systems of this world. In sharing and showing your love, he held nothing back until his mission was complete.
We remember that on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. He blessed and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this, remembering me."
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it with thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup, poured out for you and for many, is a new covenant, which is the forgiveness of sin."
He suffered as we suffer, even the sting of death. But death did not have the final word. He rose from the grave, conquering death itself, and now lives eternally with you. He will return to redeem and reconcile all of creation to make all things new. In thanksgiving, we offer our lives in love and joyful service.
Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us. Bless the bread we break and the cup we share. In this holy communion, make us one with you and with each other, so that we may become the body of Christ given to the world. Remembering our connection to each other, we offer now the prayers that are on our hearts for the church, the world, and for those we love.
This morning, we especially ask for your presence with Sharon Holly and all of her family. For Jonna Lazarus, Ellen Fisher, Elaine Sermonaro, and Tanya T. For those suffering in the wars in Ukraine, Gaza, Israel, Lebanon, and Sudan. For those struggling in the aftermath of Hurricane Helene. And for our friends in Cuba, the Dakota Presbytery, El Salvador, and friends in Cameroon. Through Christ, in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor belong to you, Almighty God, now and forever. We continue our prayer as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The bread of heaven, the cup of salvation, the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you. please rise in body or spirit and join us as we pray together. Majestic and eternal God, you have fed us with the bread of life and satisfied us with the cup of salvation. As we rise from this table, may we remember its expanse and our connection to our siblings in Christ around the globe. Make us instruments of your peace and messengers of your love in thought, word, and deed. Make us one with you and all of creation through the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and among you and between you this day and every day of your gifted life.